answer. Parker had actually attended a local tryout for the Reds in 1968, turned some heads, but ultimately couldn't sign because he was just 16 years old. Pete Rose was at that tryout on the field alongside other Reds teammates. Pete's high school alma mater, Western Hills, was a rival to Parker's Quarter Tech. Even though Charlie Hustle was about 10 years older than the Cobra, that bond, those common threads, existed. The two of them are so alike in terms of their upbringing to their style of play. When you look at Rose through the lens of Ray Fosse and see Parker through the lens of Johnny Oates or John Stearns, you discover two hard-nosed players, two former high school football stars who played the game of baseball almost the exact same way. A host of Cincinnati-born and bred players have that in them. Question. Talk about his role as a mentor to so many young black ball players. Answer. Parker learned so much from Willie Stargell and Doc Ellis and the Pirates organization, really, about giving back, about brotherhood, about looking after the young ones. He made a pledge to the Reds president and GM, Bob Housen, to help him rebuild the Big Red Machine in 1983 when they offered to bring Dave back home. And boy, he really lived up to that assurance. He loves Eric Davis, Cal Daniels, Barry Larkin, and Gary Sheffield, whom he mentored later in his career with Milwaukee, like his own children. You might even want to throw Jose Canseco in that group. Parker did his very best to keep that young megastar. And for you younger listeners, Canseco was a megastar early on in his career in the late 1980s. And Parker did his best to keep Canseco even keeled during the two seasons they played together in Oakland. I would venture to say that those who think Dave Parker is a borderline Hall of Fame candidate never take into account his contributions to the teams on which he played, which is one of the metrics that baseball writers are directed to consider when weighing a player's suitability for induction. Not only would I put Dave Parker at the top of the list for one of the five greatest teammates of all time, I believe that distinction pushes him, in addition to a few others, pushes him past the burden of proof among his peers. If you really care about the literal guidelines for enshrinement, then that metric matters. Sorry. Okay. All right, here we go. Let me take a quick sip of water. All right. One, two, three. Question. Who would you compare Parker to that is playing today? Answer. You know what? I don't think that there is a single player in the game of baseball today, Greg, who all in possesses Parker's level of confidence, his charisma, and his leadership abilities. That the type of composite athlete that was Dave Parker is probably playing football right now. And as Parker likes to say, that is a whole other story for another day. Question. Do you think he will be in the Hall of Fame or have drug issues ruin that opportunity? Let me go again. Question. Do you think he will be in the Hall of Fame or have drug issues ruin that opportunity? There was only brief mentions of his years with the A's. Parker hints that he needs to write another book on that experience. Will there be a second book? Answer. You know, when Dave Parker enters a room full of Hall of Fame baseball players, half of them cry out. I'm going to do that again. I'm sorry. Stupid email. Answer. You know, when Dave Parker enters a room full of Hall of Fame baseball players, half of them cry out Parkway and the other half yell out Cobra. He's not only considered a peer, but an elite peer. Every day of his life that he steps out of his house, a stranger smiles at Dave Parker and greets him with a hopeful hi. And to the Cobra, that's the only Hall of Fame that matters. As far as a second book goes, you know, University of Nebraska was so gracious with the handling of the narrative, they allowed us to police the length of the book after we submitted a 229,000-word manuscript. which included two chapters on Oakland, his 1990 season mentoring Sheffield and dealing with the Brewers owner, Bud Selig, and a full chapter on his final year, split between the Angels and the Toronto Blue Jays. A short story about that is actually one of my favorites in the book that I did include, that we did include. I had conducted an anecdotal survey among like 4,000 hardcore baseball book readers. I told them, Dave Parker's writing a book. What would you like to know? Most responses were about his time in Pittsburgh and the drug trials. What does the drug trials mean? That means his time with the Reds, but also a deep look at his relationship with Pete Rose. So we needed to condense the A's and Brewers chapters, the DH years, so to speak. But Parker made a deal with MLBBro.com, the new black baseball writing website, to support their efforts to showcase those lost chapters within the website's debut. Will there be another book? Well, there have been some inquiries about an assortment of ideas in different media that we're currently working on, so stay tuned on that front. Lastly, anything else to add? Dave Parker has been personally dealing with Parkinson's disease since 2012 and conducts numerous charitable efforts in the race to find a cure. His foundation, the Dave Parker 39 Foundation, lists resources and information on Parkinson's. An autographed copy of Cobra can also be obtained through the foundation's website, www.daveparker39foundation.com.
And I want to thank Dave Jordan for that interview. Some little hiccups in there, but all in all, an excellent view of the book there. Excuse me, I'm coughing, but that is a great book. Not only a great baseball book, but just a great book of just life in the in the 70s, in particular, as far as what was going on as music and what was going on in society, especially for a young African-American at that time, African-American male at that time, dealing with celebrity, dealing with just outside issues. Excellent book. So, I recommend it highly. Cobra, the story of Dave Parker, editor, author, Dave Jordan. But they both did it. You know, it's a great book. Just a great book there. And like we were talking about earlier, the chapters are named after songs. And what I'm going to do right now, I'm going to play some of the songs that are based on the chapters, starting with this rare one. This one is Gotta Get Over the Hump. This is by Simtek and Wiley. So let's hear that on the Root & Root Show.
Beat me to the got your back, it's always against the wall. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Just a moment.
Return to claim the pyramid. Partying on the mothership. I am the mothership connection. Getting down in 3D. Light year groove. Stride and dip in your hip and come on to the mothership. Loose boot, doing the bump. Hustle on over here. Bomb.